Truth is, I thought it mattered. I thought that
money
mattered. But does it bollocks? Not compared to how people matter.
Welcome, Mention, and other fine folks to the Sunday Dispatch of the Black Letter, where we contemplate thoughts worth thinking. This is your spectator of the spectacle coming to you live from deep inside the upside down. Today we're going to talk a little bit about some of the ongoing concerns related to the economy and how that's affecting all of us, really. And I'm going to try and peek behind the smoke and mirrors behind the curtain to see what the puppeteers are up to and how we can best manage our futures so that they can be brighter for us, because really nobody cares about us except for ourselves. It seems like the whole world is going to hell in a handbasket, and in the meantime we've got a drunk uncle at the wheel who's only looking out for himself and his cronies, as you know. So first off here, there's this interesting FOMC meeting transcript from October 23rd, 24th in 2012, and I wanted to bring this up because it gives you a sense of where these folks were going right back then, right? So here's Chairman Bernanke has just finished speaking, and here we have Mr. Powell, and he goes on to talk about the balance sheet of the Fed and all that kind of thing, and here the some of the concerns that they have. He says, I have concerns about more purchases, and this is Mr. Powell, who I believe is Jerome Powell. First, the question, why stop at $4 trillion? The market, in most cases, will cheer us for doing more. It will never be enough for the market. Our models will always tell us that we are helping the economy, and I will probably always feel that those benefits are overestimated. And we will be able to tell ourselves that market function is not impaired and that inflation expectations are under control. What is to stop us, other than much faster economic growth, which it is probably not in our power to produce? So he's admitting here that they can't create much faster economic growth. Second, I think we are actually at a point of encouraging risk-taking, and that should give us pause. Investors really do understand now that we will be here to prevent serious losses. It is not that it is easy for them to make money, but that they have every incentive to take more risk, and they are doing so. So here he's admitting this, right? He's admitting that this is basically creating asset bubbles in the stock market. Meanwhile, we look like we are blowing a fixed income duration bubble right across the credit spectrum that will result in big losses when rates come up down the road. You can almost say that is our strategy. And of course, there's no way they're going to be increasing their rates down the road. At least just recently he said, at least not until 2022. There's going to be zero interest rates until then, at least minimum. My third concern, and others have touched on it as well, is the problem of exiting from a near $4 trillion balance sheet. We've got a set of principles from June 2011 and have done some work since then. But it just seems to me that we seem to be way too confident that exit can be managed smoothly. Markets can be much more dynamic than we appear to think. So here we have a little bit of truthfulness, actually, back about almost 8 years ago, where he's talking about some of his concerns. A, that they are creating and incentivizing their investors, their friends, the banksters, to take on more risk. And B, how are they going to try and back out of a $4 trillion balance sheet? Now it's going to be $7-8 trillion in no time, right? $10 trillion perhaps easily by the end of the year, if not more. Anyway, I thought that was interesting. And now we'll go back to a couple of other issues. So this is the transcript here of the Fed chair, being Jerome Powell, testifying regarding the economy. And I think, let's see where this is from. This is from February 11th, 2020. So this is a while back. And it's interesting what he has to say here. I thought it'd be sort of eye-opening. These are folks that are really not interested in you and I. They are in a whole different environment. They run with different people. They're lost touch. They're out of touch with really the man on the street and the woman on the street. So, Ms. Porter. Okay, Mr. Powell, I'm going to project a picture up here so that the audience can see, but I'm also going to hold it up for you. Is this you, Mr. Powell? That is. Ms. Porter, where are you? Jerome Powell. That's a party after the alfalfa dinner, an after party that I went to. Where was that party held? It was at Jeff Bezos' home. Jeff Bezos' home? And when was it taken? Excuse me? When was this picture taken? Saturday night after the alfalfa dinner. It will take? You'll stipulate end of January 2020? Yes. Ms. Porter. Recently. Can you imagine how attending a lavish party at Jeff Bezos' $23 million home with Jared and Ivanka and the CEO of JP Morgan Chase, Jamie Dimon, might give off the sense to the public that you are not, in fact, immune from external pressures? Jerome Powell, I would certainly hope not. What did you talk about at that party with them? I didn't talk to any of the people you named. You didn't talk to anybody? I didn't talk to any of the people you named. Well, can you tell me who you did talk to? I mainly escorted my son and his brand new wife in there, and I actually introduced them to general matters. So maybe that's the truth, but optically it doesn't look good, does it? Miss Porter goes on to say, quickly, Mr. Powell, if you can just name a couple of the biggest drivers of economic growth in this country since the recession in the 1970s, what's been making our economy grow? What factors? Jerome Powell, well, the hard work of the American people. Of course, the big technology companies. Ms. Porter, Mr. Powell, would it surprise you if I told you that women in the workforce are actually a bigger driver of economic growth than technology companies? Without those women, our economy would be 25% smaller. Women grew the economy 25%. The cost of childcare shot up 2,000%. Do you know, Mr. Powell, how much childcare in America costs today? He has no idea. He says it costs a lot. Could you put it a little bit firmer? I don't. My kids are grown up all. So there you go. These are guys out of touch with reality. Doesn't even know what causes the economy to grow. And this is the chairman of the Federal Reserve, right? It's unbelievable. And just to point out that these people are connected with the highest echelon, the highest earners, the biggest corporations, the CEOs. And those are the ones that they're looking for. That's their peer group, right? They don't really give two hoots about us. And here we're talking about inequality. And this is from June 10th, which was yesterday, I believe. This is the yesterday's meeting, and he's being asked about inequality here. Inequality is something that's been with us increasingly for more than four decades. It's not really related to monetary policy. So you see how this is starting to diverge from what he was talking about back in 2012 and even before. Of course, it makes a big difference. Inequality is related to monetary policy. So monetary policy is what the central banks are in charge of, and fiscal policy is what the feds are, the government is in charge of. Anyway, so that's interesting. He says that he's not responsible, or monetary policy is not responsible for inequality. Since your March 23rd emergency announcement, every single stock in the S&P 500 has delivered positive returns. I'm wondering, given the levels of the market right now, whether you or your colleagues feel there is a possible bubble blowing that could pop and set back the recovery significantly, or that we might see capital misallocation that will leave us worse off when this is over. Second, inequality is not just about wages, it's also about wealth. A number of studies have suggested that by keeping rates low for so long and targeting the markets after the great financial crisis, that the Fed did contribute to wealth inequality in this country. I'm wondering if you think there is some tweak or some message you could give that would affect that. And then he goes on, blah, 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 talking about nonsense, circuitous conversations, really not addressing the questions. What he does say, though, is what we want is investors to be pricing in risk like markets are supposed to do. Well, they're not doing that at all, Jerome. I would say if we were to hold back because we would never do this, but the idea that just the concept that we would hold back because we think asset prices are too high, others may not think so. But we just decided that that's the case. What would happen to those people? What would happen to the people that we're actually legally supposed to be serving? You see what he's saying here? So he's concerned about asset prices being too high, and if they withhold money, what will happen to those asset prices? You read between the lines, he's suggesting that those asset prices will take a dive. And then in that case, what would happen to those people? What would happen to the people that we're actually legally supposed to be serving? And here he's confused about who he's supposed to be serving, which is the general public. And then his cronies, his buddies up in the hedge funds and the banking industry, who are actually the ones creating all this asset bubbles, right? And shame, what's going to happen to them? Again, we're not focused on moving asset prices in a particular direction at all. It's just we want markets to be working. I think partly as a result of what we've done, they are working. Clearly not. Markets are supposed to be free market capitalism, what we're supposed to have. And in free market capitalism, sometimes you have to prune the dead branches from the tree, right? In order to make for new growth. And they're not allowing for that at all. Anyway, just interesting, if you start to really read between the lines, start to see who they're actually involved with, you can figure out what's what and who's who in the zoo. This is talking about the looming bank collapse. The U.S. financial system could be on the cusp of calamity. This time we might not be able to save it. Because, as I said, you may think that a crisis is unlikely with memories of the 2008 crash still so fresh. But banks learned few lessons from that calamity. Yeah, that's true. See, to prevent the next crisis, Congress in 2010 passed the Dodd-Frank Act. Under the new rules, banks were supposed to borrow less, make fewer long-shot bets, and be more transparent about their holdings. The reforms were well-intentioned, but as we'll see, they haven't kept the banks from falling back into old bad habits. So this is part of the problem, right? So for example, they've started with CLOs, a collateralized loan obligation, which walks and talks like a CDO, right? Which was part of the problem of the collateralized debt obligations originally from 2008 and 9. So unless you work in finance, you probably haven't heard of CLOs, but according to many estimates, the CLO market is bigger than the subprime mortgage CDO market was in its heyday. So this is a real problem. So for example, here he's talking about Wells Fargo, which he has a home mortgage with and a checking account with, and the amount of CLOs that they have for sale in their books is almost $30 billion. Huge, huge number and a real risk, especially in this current environment. And he talks about how these rating agencies and the ratings that these CLOs receive is deceiving. The credit rating agencies grade CLOs and their underlying debt separately. So, plus, you know, the credit agencies are in bed with these corporations anyway, because these corporations pay the credit agencies for these credit ratings. So you can see how they're in bed together, right? You know, I think I've used this quote before, as Upton Sinclair said, it is difficult to get a man to understand something when his salary depends on his not understanding it, right? I mean, it's a total conflict of interest. It's outrageous. He goes on to say here that loan defaults are already happening. They were more in April than ever before. It will only get worse from here. And that's some darn tootin' truth. And then here's a CLO, an illustrated guide, and how these start to default. So for example, here's your collateralized loan obligations, and these are the triple B ones, these are the double B, and these are the B, and I think double B and triple B are probably considered quite risky. So here's the triple A layer is up in here, and these are the lower layers, and this is a hypothetical CLO from before the coronavirus hit, and then here's how the hypothetical CLO might have performed during the previous financial crisis. And then here's hypothetical CLO in April 2020, many loans have been downgraded by the rating agencies and defaults are increasing. You can see in the red here, the red and the pink. Well, the red especially defaulted, the pink were the ones that are starting to look suspicious. In the worst case scenario, if the present economic conditions persist or worsen, widespread defaults could hit not just the lower layers of CLOs, but the AAA layer as well. As you can see, all up here above this line is the AAA layer. So it's a real debacle waiting to happen. Anyway, that's a good article. It's long if you want to read it, but it sort of explains the position that the banks are in, which is basically the same as they were in 2008. However, they're receiving a lot more money now, so they might be okay. But it's us I'm more concerned about. Top primary silver mining industry production yield falls to the lowest level ever. So here you can see, for example, the Fresnillo mine 2005 production was 33 million ounces, and the average yield was 5.2 ounces of silver they're talking about per ton. And in 2019, they produced 13 million ounces. The average yield was 5.3 ounces per ton, right? So they're having to bring out more tonnage from the ground to get less silver. So for example, as we can see here, workers at the Fresnillo mine processed more ore in 2019 to produce 20 million fewer ounces of silver. No wonder the cost to produce silver has risen from 4 to 5 per ounce back in 2005 to over 15 plus an ounce presently. So there isn't a lot of margin here for these silver miners, right? And of course, so they're not producing as much, they're probably not investing as much in producing silver, although often arguably silver is a byproduct of other commodity mining, but still, this can only help the price of silver in the long term, I imagine. Anyway, very interesting. Just another reason why I think silver is going to be doing well in the near future. Ad Age has Starbucks anticipates a 3.2 billion coronavirus sales hit, plans faster rollout of new cafe format. And they're closing, I think, 400 stores, I've read recently somewhere as well, right? Starbucks expects the coronavirus pandemic to reduce sales this quarter by as much as 3.2 billion, dragging down the coffee chain's performance as it sees a recovery stretching into next year. The company expects to open 300 net new stores this fiscal year in the Americas, half of its earlier estimate. That includes the closure of 400 company-operated stores over the next 18 months. So we're starting to see the wheels, the training wheels of the Federal Reserve starting to come off the bicycle we're riding right into a brick wall. The five most important cryptocurrencies this year, this is just one general idea, but I like to see who's talking about cryptocurrencies and which ones might be something to be thinking about. Obviously Bitcoin, that all starts with the granddaddy of cryptocurrencies with Bitcoin. Ethereum as well is another good one for the blockchain and the dApps, the decentralized apps that are available to be built upon it. Ripple XRP, I think that could be a big up-and-comer, especially if banks get on board for international settlements or transactions, et cetera, et cetera. Litecoin is a Bitcoin junior. I think it was a fork from the original Bitcoin at some point. And then Libra, of course, which is Facebook, and I wouldn't touch that with a 10-foot pole. I don't particularly care for Facebook either, for privacy reasons, obviously. And so here's the cryptocurrencies. We'll see how they're doing right now. So you can see everything's sort of fairly flat and straight, been down a little bit after a while. So here is Bitcoin, Ethereum, XRP, which they were talking about, is down a little bit. It's below 20 cents. Haven't seen that for a while. Litecoin, $45, is also down. You can see all the charts are trending down. Cardano is an interesting one. That could be one to watch in the future. And then, of course, Stellar I like as well, but that's down a lot, hasn't been doing much. Somewhere I read that, you know, the cryptocurrencies could be in for a bit of a downward trend in the next, in the back half of this year, before I think it really starts to take up and take off. And I think the same will be for precious metals, specifically silver. There might be some opportunities to buy at lower prices in the coming months. But of course, who knows, right? I think what we need to do is to find our mindset. I'm certainly sort of a long-term investor in these things, precious metals, some cryptocurrencies, stocks, when I can find some good ones to start buying again. But, you know, if you trade, you know, that's all well and good, but I'm not sure that trading is a great long-term option unless you really know what you're doing. I certainly don't. And here's Cardano, Ethereum top chart for dev activity. So this is why I think Cardano could be a good up-and-comer coin as well. You can see here the ADA, this is Cardano, has 371 daily development projects activity in the GitHub in the last 30 days. I'm not sure which one this one is. And then, of course, here's Ethereum too. So it's looking pretty good. I think that's one reason why maybe Cardano is something to consider. I might try, you know, put $100 there over time if I can. It's a good price, as we said. Not that price is anything, but as you can see down here, Cardano only has a 2 billion market cap. It's only 8 cents per coin, per ADA. So we'll see. All right, folks. Well, that's about it. Just some things worth thinking about right now, of course, all just entertainment purposes. I'm just a rambling, random internet dude shouting my ravens from Blabberlon. So thanks for joining me. Let's have a discussion down below talking about what you're doing, where you think things are going, and how you're trying to protect your wealth and your family and savings, your financial future in the upcoming, well, I think in the next 18 months to 2 years are going to be probably where we hit the skids and bottom out, economically speaking, and probably stock market as well. Stock market is down as I said, but the stock market's way overpriced anyway. We'll see where it is. I think over the next 18 months to 2 years, the stock market really will probably hit a new bottom. But what do I know? Anyway, thanks for listening. I look forward to your comments down below. And remember, dum spiro, spero.